Thus during the life of the saint we find what has ever since remained a characteristic feature of Benedictine houses, that is the members take up any work which is adapted to their peculiar circumstances, any work which may be dictated by their necessities. Thus we find the Benedictines teaching in poor schools and in the universities, practicing the arts and following agriculture, undertaking the care of souls, or devoting themselves wholly to study. No work is foreign to the Benedictine, provided only it is compatible with living in community and with the performance of the divine office. This freedom in the choice of work was necessary in a rule which was to be suited to all times and places, but it was primarily the natural result of the end which Saint Benedict had in view, and in which he differs from the founders of later orders. These later had in view some special work to which they wished their disciples to devote themselves. Saint Benedict's purpose was only to provide a rule by which anyone might follow the gospel counsels, and live, and work and pray, and save his soul. Saint Gregory's narrative of the establishment of Monte Cassino does little more for us than to supply disconnected incidents which illustrate the daily life of the monastery. We gain only a few biographical facts. From Monte Cassino, Saint Benedict founded another monastery near Terracina, on the coast, about 40 miles distant. To the wisdom of long experience and to the mature virtues of the saint, was now added the gift of prophecy, of which Saint Gregory gives many examples. Celebrated among these is the story of the visit of Totila, king of the Goths, in the year 543, when the saint rebuked him for his wicked deeds, and in a few words told him all that should befall him, saying, "Much wickedness do you daily commit, and many sins have you done. Now at length give over your sinful life. Into the city of Rome shall you enter, and over the sea shall you pass, 9 years shall you reign, and in the tenth shall you leave this mortal life." The king, hearing these things, was wonderfully afraid, and desiring the holy man to commend him to God in his prayers he departed, and from that time forward he was nothing so cruel as before he had been. Not long after he went to Rome, sailed over into Sicily, and in the tenth year of his reign he lost his kingdom together with his life. Totila's visit to Monte Cassino in 543 is the only certain date we have in the saint's life. It must have occurred when Benedict was advanced in age. Abbot Tosti, following others, puts the saint's death in the same year. Just before his death we hear for the first time of his sister Scholastica. She had been dedicated from her infancy to our Lord, and used to come once a year to visit her brother. To whom the man of God went not far from the gate to a place that did belong to the abbey, there to give her entertainment they met for the last time 3 days before Scholastica's death, on a day when the sky was so clear that no cloud was to be seen. The sister begged her brother to stay the night, but by no persuasion would he agree unto that, saying that he might not by any means tarry all night out of his abbey. The nun, receiving this denial of her brother, joining her hands together, laid them on the table, and so bowing her head upon them, she made her prayers to Almighty God, and lifting her head from the table, there fell suddenly such a tempest of lightning and thundering, and such abundance of rain, that neither Venerable Bennett, nor the monks that were with him, could put their head out of door. 3 days later, Benedict beheld the soul of his sister, which was departed from her body, in the likeness of a dove, to ascend into heaven, who rejoicing much to see her great glory, with hymns and lauds gave thanks to Almighty God, and did impart news of this her death to his monks, whom also he sent presently to bring her corpse to his abbey, to have it buried in that grave which he had provided for himself. It would seem to have been about this time that Saint Benedict had that wonderful vision in which he came as near to seeing God as is possible for man in this life. Saint Gregory and Saint Bonaventure say that Benedict saw God and in that vision of God saw the whole world. Saint Thomas will not allow that this could have been. However, does not hesitate to say that the saint merited while still in this mortal life, to see God himself and in God all that is below him. If he did not see the Creator, he saw that light which is in the Creator, and in that light, as Saint Gregory says, saw the whole world gathered together as it were under one beam of the sun. At the same time he saw the soul of Germanus, bishop of Capua, in a fiery globe carried up by the angels to heaven. Once more the hidden things of God were shown to him, and he warned his brethren, both those that lived daily with him and those that dwelt far off, of his approaching death. 6 days before he left this world he gave orders to have his sepulchre opened, and forthwith falling into an ague, he began with burning heat to wax faint, and when as the sickness daily increased, upon the sixth day he commanded his monks to carry him into the oratory, where he did arm himself, receiving the body and blood of our Savior Christ, and having his weak body holden up betwixt the hands of his disciples, he stood with his own hands lifted up to heaven, and as he was in that manner praying, he gave up the ghost. He was buried in the same grave with his sister in the oratory of Saint John the Baptist, which he himself had built when he overthrew the altar of Apollo. There is some doubt whether the relics of the saint are still at Monte Cassino, or whether they were moved in the 7th century to Fleury. Abbot Tosti, in his Life of Saint Benedict, discusses the question at length and decides the controversy in favor of Monte Cassino. Perhaps the most striking characteristics in Saint Benedict are his deep and wide human feeling and his moderation. The former reveals itself in the many anecdotes recorded by Saint Gregory. We see it in his sympathy and care for the simplest of his monks, his hastening to the help of the poor Goth who had lost his billhook, spending the hours of the night in prayer on the mountain to save his monks the labor of carrying water, and to remove from their lives a just cause of grumbling, staying 3 days in a monastery to help to induce one of the monks to remain quietly at his prayers as the other monks did, instead of going forth from the chapel and wandering about busying himself with some earthly and transitory things. He lets the crow from the neighboring woods come daily when all are at dinner to be fed by himself. His mind is always with those who are absent. Sitting in his cell he knows that Placid is fallen into the lake, he foresees the accident to the builders and sends a warning to them. In spirit and some kind of real presence he is with the monks eating and refreshing themselves on their journey, with his friend Valentinian on his way to the monastery, with the monk taking a present from the nuns, with the new community in Terracina. Throughout Saint Gregory's narrative he is always the same quiet, gentle, dignified, strong, peace-loving man who by the subtle power of sympathy becomes the center of the lives and interests of all about him. We see him with his monks in the church, at their reading, sometimes in the fields, but more commonly in his cell, where frequent messengers find him weeping silently in his prayers, and in the night hours standing at the window of his cell in the tower, offering up his prayers to God, and often, as Totila found him, sitting outside the door of his cell, or before the gate of the monastery reading a book. He has given his own portrait in his ideal picture of an abbot. Thanks for watching, share, and subscribe for more. Saint Benedict, pray for us.